Princeton University Press Audio presents Why Trust Science by Naomi Oreskes, read by Nancy Crane, with John Chancer, Kelly Burke, Christopher Ragland, Richard Lyddon, and Kerry Shale. Trust, but verify. Ronald Reagan.
Introduction by Stephen Macedo, read by John Chancer. Science confronts a public crisis of trust. From the Oval Office in Washington and on news media around the world, the scientific consensus on climate change, the effectiveness of vaccines, and other important matters are routinely challenged and misrepresented. Doubts about science are sown by tobacco companies, the fossil fuels industry, free market think tanks, and other powerful organizations with economic interests and ideological commitments that run counter to scientific findings. Yet we know that scientists sometimes make mistakes, and that particular scientific findings, now widely believed, will turn out to be wrong. So why, when, and to what extent should we trust science? These questions could hardly be more timely or important. As extreme weather events become more common, sea levels rise, and climate-induced migrations flow across borders, nations around the world confront mounting costs and humanitarian crises. Yet so-called experts do not always agree. A local television meteorologist may report that it is merely some speculation from scientists that global warming is contributing to extreme weather events, such as the polar vortex that hit the upper Midwest and northeast of the United States in late January 2019. On another channel, a scientist at a well-regarded research center insists that we know why. It's all because of human activities increasing the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere that trap a lot more heat down by the surface. As vitally important as climate science is to the future of humanity, that is only the tip of the iceberg. Are vaccines effective? Does the birth control pill cause depression? Is flossing good for your teeth? On these questions, and so many others, scientists may agree, yet doubts circulate. Who should we believe, and why? In Why Trust Science, Professor Naomi Oreskes provides clear and compelling answers to the questions of when and why scientific findings are reliable. She explains the basis for trust in science in highly readable prose and illustrates her argument with vivid examples of science working as it should, and as it should not, on matters central to our lives. Readers will find here a vigorous defense of the trustworthiness of scientific consensus based not on any particular method or on the qualities of scientists, but on science's character as a collective enterprise. A distinguished scientist and historian of science, Professor Naomi Oreskes has also emerged as one of the world's clearest and most influential voices on the role of science in society and the reality of man-made climate change. This book grows out of the Princeton University Tanner Lectures on Human Values, delivered by Professor Oreskes in late November 2016. On that occasion, four distinguished commentators, representing a variety of fields and perspectives, responded to Professor Oreskes' two lectures. This book contains the lectures, the four commentaries, and an extended reply by Professor Oreskes, all revised and expanded. Readers will find in the chapters that follow an overview of the leading philosophical debates concerning the nature of scientific understanding, scientific method, and the role of scientific communities. Oreskes defends the role of values in science, discusses the relationship between science and religion, and sets out her own credo as a scientist and defender of science. Four commentators offer their perspectives on these issues. And Oreskes closes with comments on the plight and promise of science in our time. A more detailed overview follows. Why should we trust science? Professor Oreskes' initial answer is crisp and clear. Scientific knowledge is fundamentally consensual, and understanding science properly can help us address the current crisis of trust. Chapter 1 develops the problem of trust against the background of an account of philosophical debates about the nature of science and scientific method. In the 18th and 19th centuries and before, trust often resided in great men. Science was regarded as trustworthy insofar as the scientists were. Gradually, the alternative idea was advanced that careful observation and adherence to scientific methods were the basis of progress. Oreskes also surveys the varieties of empiricism that dominated philosophies of science in the first half of the 20th century, and the challenge advanced by Karl Popper, who regarded the essence of science not as verification, but openness to falsifiability or fallibilism. Most important, on Oreskes' account, was the emergence of the idea of science as a collective enterprise. The sociological view of science was first advanced by Ludwig Fleck in the 1930s, who held that the truly isolated investigator is impossible. Thinking is a collective activity. Oreskes endorses the idea that scientific progress depends on the collective institutions and practices of science, such as peer-reviewed journals and scientific societies through which scientists share data, grapple with criticisms, and adjust their views. The central importance of scientific communities, their worldviews, and practices is the core of Professor Oreskes' view. When we focus on what scientists do, we find a variety of methods pursued with creativity and flexibility. She explores debates surrounding philosophies of science in the work of Pierre Duhem, W.V.O. Quine, Thomas Kuhn, and others. She describes the social epistemology developed by feminist philosophers and historians of science, including the contributions of Helen Longino, who helped establish the idea that, as Oreskes puts it, objectivity is maximized when the community is sufficiently diverse that a broad range of views can be developed, heard, and appropriately considered. Or, as she says later, in diversity, there is epistemic strength. Professor Oreskes thus defends the social turn in our understanding of science, while also describing the sense of threat that greeted the idea that scientific realities are socially constructed. Remember the obvious, she advises. Scientists are engaged in sustained and careful study of the natural world. The empirical dimension is critical, but scientific expertise is also communally organized. Objectivity arises from social practices of criticism and correction, most successfully in scientific communities that are diverse, non-defensive, and self-critical. We are warranted in placing informed trust in the critically achieved consensus of the scientific community, argues Professor Oreskes. Individual scientists make mistakes, especially when they stray outside their domains of expertise, and Oreskes provides some glaring examples. And science has no monopoly on insight into the natural world. Nevertheless, the practices and procedures of scientific communities increase the odds that scientific consensus is reliable. We should trust the conclusions of the scientific community rather than the petroleum industry when it comes to climate change, because the petroleum industry has a conflict of interest. It aims to profit by finding, developing, and selling petroleum resources, and it generally does that well. But those aims conflict with the pursuit of truth regarding climate change. As a general rule, We should be skeptical of the scientific claims of organizations guided by the profit motive, or ones pre-committed to an ideological point of view. Good science presupposes that participants are interested in learning and have a shared interest in truth. It assumes that the participants do not have a major, intellectually compromising conflict of interest. And yet, scientists sometimes get things wrong. So Professor Oreskes asks in Chapter 2, how do we know that they are not wrong now? If our knowledge is perishable and incomplete, how can we warrant relying on it to make decisions, particularly when the issues at stake are often socially or politically sensitive, economically consequential, and deeply personal? To investigate these important questions, Oreskes examines 5 examples of science gone awry. What do these examples have in common, and what can we learn from them? The first is the limited energy theory, popular in the late 19th century, which held that women should not participate in higher education on the grounds that energy expended on studying would adversely affect their fertility. The withering criticism to which this theory was subjected by Dr. Mary Putnam Jacoby had, as the reader will learn, little immediate effect on male scientists. Another example is the rejection of continental drift. Many American scientists in particular were hostile to the theory, which they argued was based on flawed European methodology. A third example is eugenics, which is most closely associated nowadays with the Nazis, but which had a wide variety of advocates and practitioners in the United States and other Western countries. Oreskes provides a fascinating account of the complex politics of eugenics in the United States and Europe. Oreskes's fourth example is hormonal birth control and the evidence that it often causes depression. Many women experience the onset of depression after beginning certain birth control formulas, and Professor Oreskes relates her own experience. Yet medical science, long discounted as unreliable, the self-reports of millions of women. Oreskes' final case is dental floss, and the flurry of news reports asserting that there is no hard evidence that flossing is effective. Probing deeper, Oreskes argues that the lack of randomized trials to test for the effects of flossing hardly amounts to a lack of evidence. From these diverse cases, Professor Oreskes draws some general lessons, which she groups under the themes of consensus, method, evidence, values, and humility. The importance of hard-won scientific consensus as an indicator of trustworthiness holds up very well across the 5 cases. Oreskes also provides a fascinating discussion on the difficult question, vital to the role of science in a democracy, of non-expert opinion and how scientists should respond to it. Non-scientists, from nurses and midwives to farmers and fishermen, often have information or evidence relevant to science-based decisions. Patients have vital information about their symptoms. Yet, just because someone is close to an issue does not mean he or she understands it. Conventional notions of objectivity assume distance for just this reason. The cases help illustrate and sharpen the distinction between reliable scientific authority and the interest and ideology-based pseudoscientific dissent we witness surrounding climate change, evolution, and vaccines. Drawing from her 5 examples, Oreskes warns of the methodological fetishism that leads some scientists to dismiss valuable forms of evidence because they do not fit their methodological pre-commitments. Evidence comes in a variety of forms. Values inevitably play a role in shaping science, Oreskes insists. In looking back on eugenics, Scientists may say that science was distorted by values. But values were also central to opposing eugenics and also the limited energy theory. Because values play an inevitable role, diverse scientific communities are more likely to be able to detect unexamined assumptions, blind spots, and inherited biases. A community with diverse values is more likely to identify and challenge prejudicial beliefs embedded in or masquerading as scientific theory. She also allows that there can be legitimate non-scientific objections, including ones based on religious or moral values, to policies that are justified partly by science, but also by particular value claims. And humility is important. Diverse scientific communities can correct for the blind spots of arrogant scientists, but the history of science counsels humility. The greatest scientists, and one might add philosophers, have sometimes become fetishists about method, drawn false conclusions from evidence, and fallen prey to the prejudices and biases of their times. Even the best of scientists should remember that a complete grasp of the whole truth is yet far beyond us. So when should we trust science? In concluding Chapter 2, Oreskes summarizes, when an expert consensus emerges in a scientific community that is diverse and characterized by ample opportunities for peer review and openness to criticism. Of course, any particular scientific claim may be false, so she reminds us of Pascal's wager. Consider the stakes of error. It may not be certain that flossing will be good for your teeth, but it is cheap and easy. It may not be certain that human actions and policy changes can reverse the dire effects of climate change. But consider the calamities that await our children and grandchildren if we now ignore scientific predictions that are correct. In a coda to her two lectures, Professor Oreskes returns to the issue of scientists' values. In theory, scientific findings are one thing, and the question of what, if anything, to do about them is another. So one might suppose that whereas the practical question of what is to be done inevitably implicates values, the question of what scientific evidence shows need not. Ideally, science should be able to leave political and moral controversies to others. Things are not so neat and simple, however. Professor Oreskes observes that people equate science with what they think are its implications. Fundamentalist and evangelical Christians from William Jennings Bryan to Rick Santorum have worried that evolutionary accounts of human origins undermine human dignity and morality by making humans, in Santorum's words, mistakes of nature. Skepticism about climate science, on the other hand, is fed by the suspicion that environmentalists seek to undermine the American way of life. Big cars, motorboats, and high consumption. In the face of such suspicions, it is profoundly mistaken, argues Oreskes, for scientists to retreat to value neutrality. In the face of the question, why should ordinary people trust science and take it seriously? It cannot be effective to reply that scientists lack values. That is precisely what worries people. Moreover, it is perfectly obvious that scientists do have values, everyone does, and that those values influence their work. To hide your values, Oreskes observes, is to hide your humanity. So, scientists should be honest about their values. Many people will share those values, and on that basis, trust can be built. The creation revered by Christians is the biodiversity cherished by scientists, says Oreskes, and the evidence is overwhelming that these are now gravely threatened. In concluding, Professor Oreskes offers an eloquent summary of her own credo, her guiding values as a scientist and environmentalist. If we fail to act on our scientific knowledge, and it turns out to be right, people will suffer, and the world will be diminished. In the next section of this volume, four distinguished commentators expand upon, elaborate, or criticize central features of Professor Oreskes' lectures. Professor Susan Lindy is the Janice and Julian Bears Professor of History and Sociology of Science at the University of Pennsylvania, where she also holds a variety of administrative posts. Lindy argues that in responding to scientific skepticism, we should draw attention to the science that we encounter and rely upon constantly in our everyday lives. We should work our way up from the toaster to the frozen peas, the smartphones, and the other miracles of modern science and technology that enhance our lives. Of course, science's contributions are not always so positive. Professor Lindy reminds us of the 20th century's brutal history of technology-enhanced warfare. She suggests that historians of science have sought to distance pure science from technological applications because of technology's profoundly mixed legacy. Atomic scientists sought to maintain their moral purity by attributing the design of the bomb to mere engineers. Mark Lang is the Theda Purdue Distinguished Professor and Department Chair in Philosophy at the University of North Carolina, where he specializes in the philosophy of science. Lang notes that the question of why we should trust science seems to lead into a vicious circularity. Isn't peer review just experts vouching for other experts? Professor Lang suggests that asking for an external vindication of science as a whole may be unreasonable. Science is self-correcting in that it can subject any particular scientific claim to critical scrutiny. But science cannot reasonably be expected to put all its theories in jeopardy at once. Lang also raises the issue of what Thomas Kuhn described as revolutionary challenges to entire worldviews or paradigms, in which methods and theories interpenetrate. Using the example of Galileo, he suggests that there is typically sparse common ground across paradigm shifts, and scientists can use it to build an argument for one of the rival theories against the others. Lang closes by urging philosophers and others to stop overemphasizing incommensurability and underdetermination, and to devote more attention to positive accounts of the logic underlying scientific reasoning. Otmar Edenhofer is Deputy Director and Chief Economist at the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research, as well as a professor at the Technical University, Berlin. He offered a comment in Princeton and is joined here by Martin Kovarsch, who is head of the Working Group on Scientific Assessments, Ethics, and Public Policy at the Mercator Research Institute. They began by suggesting that the Trump administration accepts much climate science but opposes ambitious climate change mitigation efforts, partly because it heavily discounts the cost of climate change outside the United States. Thus, scientific consensus does not equal policy consensus. And so they ask how Oreskes' account of trust in science may need to be extended or amended for science-based policy assessments. They advise experimentation aimed at incremental learning about alternative policy pathways, and argue that costly mistakes have been made due to insufficient awareness of the complexity of the policy alternatives. Edenhofer and Kovarsch agree with Oreskes that value neutrality is impossible. They build on Deweyan pragmatism to propose that all socially important values, equality, liberty, purity, nationalism, etc., should be included in policy assessments. This may open the door to new and creative proposals. Finally, John Krosnick offers some thoughts, inspired by Professor Oreskes's lectures on the current state and future of science. Krosnick is Frederick O. Glover Professor in Humanities and Social Sciences and Professor of Communication, Political Science, and Psychology at Stanford University, where he also directs the Political Psychology Research Group. Professor Krosnick describes a number of famous, now infamous, and influential scientific findings in biomedicine, psychology, and elsewhere, whose results scientists have been unable to replicate. In some cases, the data were fabricated. In other cases, investigators admitted to repeating an experiment until the desired result was produced. Flawed research results partly from faulty methods, argues Krosnick, and also the desire for career advancement. Academic departments and professions place a premium on publishing surprising and counterintuitive findings. Is it any wonder that many of these prove unfounded on closer inspection? Journals rarely publish negative results, so refutation of bad research is slowed. He insists that scientists must face up to the problems and address the counterproductive motivations that are now rampant. In her wide-ranging reply to critics, Professor Oreskes deepens and enriches her argument. She praises Susan Lindy for her brilliant historical account of scientists' attempts to distance themselves from the technological applications of their work, yet expresses doubt that becoming clearer-eyed about the science embodied in frozen peas and smartphones will have much effect on people's attitudes to climate science. Americans do not reject science in general, but rather particular scientific claims and conclusions that clash with their economic interests or cherished beliefs. In response to Mark Lang, Professor Oreskes expresses doubt that trust in scientific experts is viciously circular. The social markers of expertise are evident to non-experts, she argues, and it is relatively easy to figure out that climate science deniers are non-experts and that the American Enterprise Institute is pre-committed to certain policy outcomes. Expert scientific consensus does tend to be reliable. In response to Edenhofer and Kovarsh, Professor Oreskes agrees that more work is needed on how to move from science to policy. Yet she insists that when powerful actors seek to undermine public trust in the science associated with progressive climate policy, the roots of their skepticism are typically not in distrust of science, but rather in economic self-interest and ideological commitments. Oreskes reiterates that if scientists are honest about their values, as she recommends, then they will often find that there is considerable overlap on the values behind climate policy disagreements, and this may help us build greater trust. Professor Oreskes turns, finally, to John Krosnick's assertion that science faces a replication crisis. While allowing that there have been notable examples, often involving the misuse of statistics, she points out that the rate of retractions, that is, retractions as a percentage of published articles, is tiny, perhaps less than 0.01%. If the rate has risen, that may reflect a salutary increase in critical scrutiny of findings, rather than a higher incidence of faulty research. Or it may reflect unwarranted media coverage of flashy single-paper results in psychology and biomedicine. Oreskes pushes back against Krosnick's wider suggestions about a crisis in science. His examples furnish no evidence that fraud is commoner in science than elsewhere. Moreover, in some of Krosnick's examples, fraud was discovered and punished expeditiously. Refutation and retraction are paths to progress. She reminds us that her argument has been that we should trust scientific consensus, not the single studies to which Krosnick draws attention, and reiterates that motivated industry funding of research is a serious problem. In an afterword penned just before this book went to press, Professor Oreskes notes that the problem of trust in science, and in news and information more generally, has exploded since she delivered the Princeton-Tanner lectures in the fall of 2016. Many more Americans believe in the reality of climate change than once did, but America is led by a science and fact-denying chief executive who is reversing hard-won progress on climate policy. It remains the case that much doubt about consensus findings in science is manufactured by those with financial or ideological interests in derailing science-based policies, just as she and Eric Conway argued in Merchants of Doubt. Professor Oreskes closes by reiterating that science merits our trust when scientific results achieve consensus among the expert members of diverse and self-critical scientific communities. And she offers a final example, controversies over the use of sunscreen, to illustrate this book's core theme. Like all excellent books, this one addresses many questions and also raises some. While Professor Oreskes argues that progress and reliability in science depends more on the qualities of scientific communities than on the character of individual scientists, she also argues that scientists inevitably have values and that they should be honest about them. Do not well-working scientific communities depend on the predominance of good values, of intellectual honesty and truth-seeking among scientists? And if diversity is important in scientific communities, of what kinds? The inclusion of women and members of racial, ethnic, religious, and other minority populations has obviously been very good for all of the sciences, and scholarship generally. Are there social sciences, and perhaps other fields of inquiry, in which greater ideological diversity would be helpful? Readers will come away from this volume armed with a far better understanding of the vitally important enterprise of modern science and the reasons why we should trust scientific consensus. All who care about the future of humanity on this fragile earth should hope that this timely and important book gains a wide audience before it is too late.
Chapter 1. Why Trust Science? Perspectives from the History and Philosophy of Science. The Problem. Many people are confused about the risks involved in vaccination, the causes of climate change, what to do to stay healthy, and other matters that fall within the domain of science. Immunologists tell us that vaccines are generally safe for most people, have protected millions of people from deadly and disfiguring diseases, and do not cause autism. Atmospheric physicists tell us that the buildup of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere is warming the planet, driving sea level rise and extreme weather events. Dentists tell us to floss our teeth. But how do they know these things? How do we know they're not wrong? Each of these claims is disputed in the popular press and on the internet, sometimes by people who claim to be scientists. Can we make sense of competing claims? Consider three recent examples. 1. In a 2016 presidential debate, Donald Trump rejected the position of medical professionals, including that of fellow candidate, physician Ben Carson, on the safety of vaccination. Recounting the experience of an employee whose child was vaccinated and later diagnosed as autistic, Mr. Trump stated his view that vaccines should be given at lower doses and be more widely spaced. Few medical professionals share his view. They consider delaying vaccination to increase the risk that infants and children will contract dangerous and otherwise preventable diseases such as measles, mumps, diphtheria, tetanus, and pertussis. Some of the children who contract these diseases will become gravely ill or die. Others will survive but pass on the infections to others. Yet Mr. Trump is not alone in making this suggestion. Prominent celebrities have made similar exhortations. Many parents now reject the advice of their physicians and choose to have their children vaccinated on a delayed schedule or not at all. As a result, morbidity and mortality from preventable infectious diseases are on the rise. 2. The Vice President of the United States, Mike Pence, is a young earth creationist, meaning that he believes that God created the earth and all it contains less than 10,000 years ago. The consensus of scientific opinion is that Earth is 4.5 billion years old, that the genus Homo emerged 2 to 3 million years ago, and that anatomically modern humans appeared about 200,000 years ago. While science cannot answer the question of whether God, or any supernatural being or force, guided the process, most scientists are persuaded that life on Earth evolved largely through the process of natural selection over the course of Earth's history, that humans share a common ancestor with chimpanzees and other primates, and that divine intervention is not required to explain the existence of Homo sapiens sapiens. Do Americans lean toward the scientific view or the Pencean view? The answer depends a bit on how you ask the question, but if you are a religious person in America who attends church regularly, the chances are high that you agree with Mike Pence. 67% of regular churchgoers believe that God created humans in their present form within the last 10,000 years. Some of us may think that these people are all Republicans, but we would be wrong. According to the Gallup polling organization, while 58% of Republicans agreed with the statement that God created humans in their present form within the last 10,000 years, so did 39% of independents and 41% of Democrats. Given this popular support for creationism, it is perhaps unsurprising that in 2012, the state of Tennessee enacted what some have called a 21st century monkey law, empowering teachers to teach creationism in science classrooms. Despite repeated rejection of previous laws of this type by U.S. courts, many states continue to attempt to enact comparable laws. 3. The American Enterprise Institute, AEI, is a long-established and well-funded think tank in Washington, D.C., committed to principles of laissez-faire economics, market-based mechanisms to social problems, limited federal government, and low rates of taxation. The Institute has long promoted skepticism about the scientific evidence for anthropogenic climate change and disparaged the conclusions of the scientific community, including the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC. AEI scholars have suggested that climate scientists are suppressing dissent within their community. The Institute at one point offered a cash incentive to anyone willing to search for errors in IPCC reports. Jeffrey Sachs, head of the Earth Institute at Columbia University from 2002 to 2016, and special advisor to UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres on the Millennium Development Goals, has said of one well-known AEI scholar that he distorts, misrepresents, or simply ignores relevant scientific conclusions. In 2016, this particular scholar referred to scientists as an interest group, demanding to know why scientific analysis conducted or funded by an agency headed by political appointees, buffeted by political pressures, should be viewed ex ante as any more authoritative than that originating from, say, the petroleum industry. I am no fan of the American Enterprise Institute. With my colleague, Eric M. Conway, I have shown how they, along with other think tanks promoting laissez-faire approaches to social and economic issues, have persistently misrepresented or mischaracterized scientific findings on climate change, as well as a variety of public health and environmental questions. They are no fans of mine either. Their scholars have attacked my work on scientific consensus. But the question raised is a legitimate one. Should a scientific analysis be viewed as ex ante authoritative? Is it reasonable to take the default position that the scientific community can in general be trusted on scientific matters, but the petroleum industry, to use his example, cannot? Science in North American universities and research institutes is generally well-funded and respected, typically much more so than the arts and humanities. But outside these hallowed halls, something very different is transpiring. The idea that science should be our dominant source of authority about empirical matters, about matters of fact, is one that has prevailed in Western countries since the Enlightenment. But it can no longer be sustained without an argument. Should we trust science? If so, on what grounds and to what extent? What is the appropriate basis for trust in science, if any? This is an academic problem, but one with serious social consequences. If we cannot answer the question of why we should trust science, or even if we should trust it at all, then we stand little chance of convincing our fellow citizens, much less our political leaders, that they should get their children vaccinated, floss their teeth, and act to prevent climate change. Scholars' views on the answer to this question have changed dramatically, and more than once in the past century. Moreover, some of the answers that scientists offer are manifestly contradicted by historical evidence. It is routine, for example, for scientists to insist that their theories must be correct because they work. How else, they argue, would planes fly or medicines cure disease? But utility is not truth. We can identify many theories in the history of science that worked and later were rejected as wrong. The Ptolemaic system of astronomy, the caloric theory of heat, classical mechanics, and the contraction theory of the Earth explained observed phenomena and made successful predictions and are now on the scrap heap of history. Many scholars in the history and philosophy of science and science studies have, however, recently converged on a new view that does hold up to scrutiny, of scientific knowledge as fundamentally consensual. This consensual view of science can help us address the current crisis of trust. The dream of positive knowledge. Throughout the 18th and early 19th centuries, most scholars located the authority of science in the authority of the man of science. The results of scientific investigations were trustworthy to the extent that the people who undertook them were. This is one reason why scientific honor societies, such as the Royal Society or the Académie des Sciences, were created. To acknowledge and identify the worthies, whose opinions on scientific matters should be sought, trusted, and heeded. These societies serve to identify the individuals whose work was considered worthy of acceptance. In the United States, this ideal was instantiated in the creation of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences during the Civil War to advise President Lincoln. Identifying these great men of science would enable the president to get the reliable advice he needed. However, in the mid-19th century, a substantive intellectual shift occurred, driven to a significant extent by the work of Auguste Comte, 1798 to 1857, variously credited as the founder of sociology, the founder of philosophy of science in its modern form, and the founder of the philosophical school known as positivism. Comte's work is abundant and complex, and subject to various considerations and reconsiderations, refutations and restorations, but the most important aspect for our purposes is his commitment to the idea of positive knowledge. Science, Comte believed, was uniquely able to provide positive, which is to say reliable, knowledge. While the term positive knowledge is no longer much used, apart from academics discussing it most often as a discredited concept, the idea persists in our linguistic conventions. We still retain the notion of something being absolutely, positively true. In English, we can ask, "Are you positive?" To which you may reply, "Yes, I'm positive." For Comte, the key element in the concept of positive knowledge is method, which he contrasted with doctrine, whether religious, superstitious, or metaphysical. The doctrines of religion and metaphysics, he argued, were forms of bias and blinkering that impeded intellectual and social progress, which the method of science, by contrast, could provide. By applying method to the pursuit of knowledge, science had the potential to liberate men and women from the shackles of religion and superstition. Comte's philosophy, like many in the 19th century, including famously Marxism, was teleological, He saw human history as being characterized by three stages: the theological or fictitious, the metaphysical or abstract, and the scientific or positive. These were not necessarily sequential, they might coexist within a society or even within a person. But overall, the direction of progress was from theology to science, with metaphysics serving as a necessary transition. In the positive stage of human development, theology and metaphysics are replaced by scientific reasoning, and scientific reasoning is rooted in observation. It has been argued that Kant was seeking to replace conventional religion with a new religion of science, and there is some justice to this claim. Teleology is a common feature of many religions. He accepted that people had a need for moral principles, but thought those principles could be found in the humanistic ideals of truth, beauty, goodness, and commitment to others. He also believed that people had a need for ritual, and proposed to replace the veneration of Christian saints with a set of positivist heroes. In his own life, he set aside time for meditation and affirmation of his central values. But whether his views were quasi-religious or not, the key point for our discussion is that for Kant and generations of those who followed him, knowingly or not, science was reliable because of its commitment to method. This leads one to ask, what is that method? Kant was sensitive to the variety of scientific disciplines that were developing at that time. He did not assert that their practices were uniform, but he did believe that they shared a fundamental characteristic of the positive state of human existence. He wrote, "In the positive state, the human mind, recognizing the impossibility of obtaining absolute truth, gives up the search after the origin and hidden causes of the universe and a knowledge of final causes of phenomena. It endeavors now only to discover, by a well-combined use of reasoning and observation, the actual laws of phenomena, that is to say, their invariable relations of succession and likeness. The explanation of facts, thus reduced to its real terms, consists henceforth only in the connection established between different particular phenomena and some general facts, the number of which the progress of science tends more and more to diminish." In stressing the importance of empirical regularities, Kant was making an argument similar to the British empiricists, particularly David Hume. He acknowledged his debt to British empiricism, particularly the work of Francis Bacon, writing, "All competent thinkers agree with Bacon that there can be no real knowledge except that which rests upon observed facts." But he was not the naive positivist that some later commentators made him out to be. He was a sophisticated thinker who recognized that our theories structure our observations as much as our observations structure our theories. If we consider the origin of our knowledge, it is no less certain that, as every positive theory must necessarily be founded upon observations, it is, on the other hand, no less true that in order to observe, our mind has need of some theory or others. If in contemplating phenomena, we did not immediately connect them with some principles, not only would it be impossible for us to combine these isolated observations and therefore to derive any profit from them, but we should even be entirely incapable of remembering the facts, which would for the most part remain unnoted by us. We can understand, therefore, why primitive humans had need of religion, superstition, and metaphysics. These early concepts were a step toward apprehending the world around us. We need not disdain or disparage these early stages in human development. We simply need to recognize and accept that to move forward, to identify the true laws that govern nature, our thinking needs to be grounded upon observation. In his words, "We must proceed sometimes from facts to principles, and at other times from principles to facts, but ultimately we will establish as a logical thesis that all our knowledge must be founded upon observation." Kant was also a fallibilist. He recognized that our views would grow and change, and that his own vision would in time be modified. Indeed, if his basic concept was correct, then the progress of knowledge would necessarily modify our views, and we might note that the persistence of religion has falsified a key element in his teleology. But to his credit, Kant was consistent insofar as he insisted that future change in our thinking would be the outcome of our observations. Kant was also reflexive, recognizing that the practices of observation must themselves be subject to observation. An improved knowledge of positive method must come, therefore, not by theorizing it, but by studying it. We must observe science in order to understand it. Kant thus anticipated Bruno Latour in his anthropological studies of laboratory science by more than a century when he held, "When we want not only to know what the positive method consists in, but also to have such a clear and deep knowledge of it to be able to use it effectively, we must consider it in action." Kant's key move was to insist that science is reliable not by virtue of the character of its practitioner, but by virtue of the nature of its practices. We need to attend to these practices by studying them empirically. The key questions, then, for those who took up the Kantian program were, what exactly are those practices? Is there a scientific method? Varieties of empiricism. For 20th century empiricists, which we have come to call logical positivists or logical empiricists, the answer to the question of the method of science was the principle of verification.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.